One of the things that, one of the many things that you bring to the faith, Scott, and to the many people who, they, you know, they walk into a talk of yours not knowing who you are, or they take a course of yours, or they've heard your, one of your many, many tapes, is this fire for evangelization. Not just head knowledge, not knowing about Jesus, not the requisite number of facts, not creedal propositions to which you have to adhere, but to know Christ as a best friend, as a savior. Maybe we can start with a definition. What is the new evangelization? Our formal topic here is apologetics in the new evangelization. What does that phrase mean in the thinking of Blessed John Paul II? What's the provenance of the term, and what's it mean?
Let me take a giant step back and try to answer that in two stages. First, I don't know if you remember a friend, Father Ed Wade. He was up in Canada.
I do remember Father Ed Wade.
Yeah. He listened to me give two or three lectures to a group of seminarians. And the he came up to me afterwards, and he said, Scott, he was waving his finger in my face. He said, I know what you are. You're not just a biblical scholar. You're not a theologian. You're an evangelistic theologian. And I never heard that description before, but as soon as those words came out of his mouth, it was just like a light came on. I'm like, that's exactly right. Because the fire of the fire and light of the truth that I had been studying had been so powerful in my life. I didn't know how to kind of restrain myself the way most of my professors seemed so good at in presenting it in a way that was just simply tame. And I've reflected upon that many times. That was said to me, I think, in the early 90s. And so when I approached the new evangelization that John Paul launched and now Benedict has extended, it was not without a great deal of excitement, you know, because in fact, this is really what is the church's essential mission. And, you know, we talk about evangelization and the new evangelization. Evangelizing, obviously, is just sharing the good news. So what's so new about evangelization? Well, I think we have to recognize the principal emphasis of the new evangelization that makes it new is not just that Catholics are evangelizing for a change. It's that we're evangelizing a secularized world. We're having to re-evangelize a de-Christianized world. And so whenever you consider the sources of this, going all the way back to JP II, but even before him to his predecessor, Pope Paul VI, he is the one who in 1975 really sowed the acorn and has now become sort of the oak tree, this big priority for the church. When he wrote Evangelii Nuntiandi, he was taking what had been so emphasized in Vatican II, but in the 10 years after the close of Vatican II, from 65 to 75, nobody had picked up on this. But here is Vatican I that doesn't use the word evangelize a single time in any of its documents, whereas Vatican II uses the term evangelize over 150 times. And so it's really a unique emphasis precisely because the church in the 60s is beginning to recognize that the culture is now awash in secularism and it's not getting better but worse. So what are we going to do? Well, you know, I think Paul VI had that intuition that came out in 75. And then as soon as Wojtyla became John Paul in 78, he began to talk about it. But he didn't actually coin the phrase until 83, when he was in Port-au-Prince, Haiti. And when he spoke of the new evangelization for the first time, he actually targeted, he began targeting not 83 and 84, but 1992, because he described it as the 500th year anniversary of the first founding and first evangelizing of the Americas. And how much had shifted in 500 years now that the three most populous Catholic countries are Brazil, Mexico, and America, which didn't exist as countries 5 centuries before. So he could recognize the need for that. And so in 1990, he came out with that masterful encyclical Redemptoris Missio, where he is really making the new evangelization front and center. And then in 92, he came out with a famous address, Base the New Evangelization on the Eucharist, which we might want to come back to. But he also announced that the World Youth Day would be in Denver. Before Denver, it had been in Częstochowa. It had been
Santiago de Compostela.
It had been in Catholic countries where you had a pilgrimage tradition. And so all of the experts just chided him and said, you know, this is a formula for failure. And then it succeeded beyond even the optimist's expectations. In 93, World Youth Day in Denver launched the new evangelization, not just in Colorado, but it really became the center and vortex for everything in the U.S., Canada, and in Central and South America as well.
I've given to believe that I wasn't in the room, but the Holy Father told Cardinal Stafford, as I understand, that Denver will be one of the centers of the new evangelization. I mean, Denver where? Denver who? Right. And look at Denver now. You know, it's
My son lives out there. Mm-hmm. He's a focused missionary. And so I hear it from all of his friends that, oh, yeah, that was the statement made by John Paul to Cardinal Stafford.
It's 8 after the hour. If you've just joined us, you're listening to Catholic Answers Live. Our guest is Dr. Scott Hahn. We're talking about evangelization in the new apologetics in the new evangelization. How about next hour we say it's apologetics and the new evangelization?
That would work.
How about near or if? No. The toll-free number is 888-31-TRUTH, 1-888-318-7884. What about people who say that programs is what the church needs? It needs a program with a curriculum, which ends up in a way being the old evangelization with the new label, here it is, blah, 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 blah.
Well, I don't want to speak against programs, but programs are always a means to an end, whereas the church's mission is the end. And so if you can develop programs that are really ordered properly to advancing the church's mission in evangelizing, in catechizing, in sacramentalizing, then of course the programs are going to work. But so often programs are a substitute for vision. Programs are a substitute for mission. Programs are what keep people employed and ultimately can frequently bureaucratize the church.
Yeah, and maybe part of the appeal is that a lot of it can be quantified.
That's right.
And justified to a board or
that's
something.
Right. Mm-hmm. But it's important also to recognize another component about Catholic evangelization. I'm not going to be able to get into it in depth right now, but just to say that it's not something that you can just begin and end in one day. Non-Catholic evangelists will share the gospel, lead you into the sinner's prayer, and assure you when you've said the amen that you're saved, once saved, always saved. And many of them will add, it doesn't really matter what you do because you're in heaven. And I would say that Catholic evangelization, following the cue that was given to us by John Paul II and emphasized even more so perhaps by Benedict, evangelization in general, but the new evangelization in particular, ought to be based upon the Eucharist. In which case, it's really about falling in love in stages. It's sort of like courtship, engagement, and marriage. That's how the old evangelization worked in the early church. You would evangelize, and the result would be converts. And what would they do? They would enroll and become catechumens. And then the catechumens would approach the Easter Vigil and become communicants. So evangelizing was ordered to catechizing, but you didn't cease to evangelize when you catechize because the good news gets better. And likewise, when they're sacramentalized, you don't stop evangelizing because the whole point of sharing the mystery of Christ is the ultimate evangelization. Now we find ourselves in the awkward situation of needing to evangelize the baptized, needing to re-evangelize the sacramentalized, as well as, and this is where apologetics comes in, sacramentalizing those who are evangelized.
Well, that's a nice point at which to put a comma. We'll come back. We'll take a break and take your calls, dear listener, for Dr. Scott Hahn. 888-31-TRUTH. That is the toll-free phone number. Special invite to our international listeners. We've got supporters and fans of the show in Australia, in New Zealand, in the land of tomorrow. We have listeners in Malaysia, in Singapore, in the UK, all across Africa. If you do call from outside the contiguous USA, we put you to the front of the line. Our guest is Dr. Scott Hahn. 888-31-TRUTH. Scott is a man, among other things, who's forgotten more about memory loss than I'll ever remember. Thank you. 888-31-TRUTH. Catholic Answers Live returns after these words, and we'll get to a little bit of the history of apologetics. It's kind of fascinating. And all that and much more after these words. Touching that dial is strictly prohibited.